Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I have the pleasure of presiding over this conversation about diplomacy and deterrence. And we're going to get started today by having our panelists introduce themselves. My name is Camille Stewart. I'm the Global Head of Product Security Strategy at Google, where I sit at the intersection of our product security teams and our central security team. And I have worked across government and private sector on cybersecurity issues for a number of years.
I'm Emily Harding. I am the Deputy Director of the International Security Program at the Center for Strategic and International Studies, which is a very long title that just means that I get to oversee the work of about 50 scholars doing tremendous work in intelligence, defense, and tech policy. Before that, I spent almost two decades working in the federal government, both in the Senate and Senate Intelligence Committee, and then in the intelligence community, and a couple years at the White House.
I'm John Hultquist. I'm from Mandiant's Intelligence Analysis Shop. We look at threats from all over the world using our incident response and a dozen different ways to sort of collect this data. We bring it all back to one centralized intelligence hub where we are sort of developing intelligence on threats around the world. Been with various versions of Mandiant for about 12 years. Before that, I was with DIA and diplomatic security at state, mostly looking at the Russian threat.
Great. Max, you want to?
And my name is Max Smeets. I'm a senior researcher at ETA Zurich, the Center for Security Studies, and also direct the European Cyber Conflict Research Initiative.
Wonderful. As you can see, we've got a great panel ahead. And what I'm actually going to do is have each of them give about a 2-minute overview on their thoughts on diplomacy and deterrence in this space. And we'll use that as a foundation for our conversation. Emily, would you like to get started?
Sure, I'll get started. So it's an interesting and a very broad topic. I think that you need to take it back to basics when you're speaking about operations in the cyber domain. Right now, there's no common lexicon, no real norms and understandings. My colleague Jim Lewis at CSIS has done some really tremendous work in international agreements around cybersecurity and cyber issues, but those have yet to really gel into a broad set of norms that govern work in the cyber domain. There's no agreement on what is cyber crime, what is cyber espionage, what is a cyber attack, what is cyber war. You have politicians who sometimes understand the cyber domain and sometimes really don't, calling things just willy-nilly, oh, it's an act of war. Well, is it? What does that really mean if it is? So given that, why is this so hard? Why is it difficult? It really is a combination of things. You know, when you're thinking about something that's a game-changing technology, stingers in Afghanistan, hypersonic weapons, nuclear weapons, those all came with a debate around what norms govern them and how they should be used. What is a proportional response? We haven't really gotten there yet in the cyber domain. And it's partially this combination of two things. The speed of attribution is very difficult in this domain, and John can talk extensively about this. He's done tremendous work in this field. There's also, as sort of a partner to that, the ease of deniability. Actors have proven themselves really adept at staying arm's length removed from any kind of cyber activity that they don't want to claim, and then claiming it when they do. And that combination of things makes it very challenging for policymakers, people who, you know, sat at the NSC like I did, to make decisions about what to do to respond to a cyber attack, to a cyber operation. What does this mean and how do we react to it? It also means that it prevents the threat that is at the core of deterrence. And that is a quick and a decisive response to an activity. If you can't attribute it quickly, and if you don't have a set of policy options ready to go, it's very difficult to pull something on the shelf and respond immediately and thus send a message or deter future action. I can talk about this a lot more later, but in the 2016 election interference that we saw the Russians do, when we were studying this on the Senate Intelligence Committee, we saw this play out in excruciating detail within the Obama administration. And really, I have all the sympathy in the world for them. They were in what they saw as a totally unprecedented situation, and they were under attack, but they could not say with 100% certainty from who and what that meant. And that delay in attribution, that inability to pull something off the shelf and immediately deploy it, had nearly disastrous consequences. That's something we can't afford to do 4 years, 5 years, 6 years later. It's time to actually get that settled and move forward. I think that we will get better. We will get faster. Folks like John who are doing this work are already making tremendous strides in that attribution piece, in trying to get to a place where we can act quickly. I think there's a really solid story to be told right now about Ukraine that is really just sort of emerging. So I have hope for the future. It's just that right now, I think that we still need to really wrap our heads around this as an issue.
Great, thank you. John.
I've been asked, I think the last, four months now, since, Christmas or the beginning of the year, what's the likelihood of an incident against NATO, of allies, against the United States? And I think, usually turn into good-natured arguments, but there's a question of whether or not any cyber attack against the United States would be crossing a major red line. And I've argued that it doesn't cross a major red line. That the one thing that I think one of the most important things we have to sort of keep in mind, we're talking about cyber attacks. And when I say cyber attacks, whether I'm talking about disruptive, destructive stuff, everything from hitting an industrial control system to NotPetya-like, just widespread destructive event. But the word I keep throwing around is limited, right? Those incidents, we've seen many of them already, were largely limited, right? They didn't take a society and bring it to its knees. They didn't bring the economy to a major halt. They are survivable. We will probably for a society that's already experienced COVID-19, a lot of the effects may not necessarily even register. The reason these actors carry out these incidents, right, is not to bring society to their knees. I don't think they have any question. There's any major question of the prospects of turning out the power for 3 hours at a time is really going to have that effect. They do it for the sort of psychological effects. They do it to undermine institutions, right? They do it to undermine your sense of security, your sense of, particularly, in places like Ukraine, their belief that the system is safe. In the United States in 2016, they did to undermine our elections, right? We had actors in systems where they could conceivably, make some edits or changes to the system or maybe alter some things, but really they weren't going to change the election. And I don't think they have any, at the command level there, they have they don't expect to do that. What they expect to do, though, is to change our reliance on those elections and our belief that those elections were secure, right? It's always about undermining our institutions. So the real important watchword here is limited, right? And that plays two roles, though, right? It's good news somewhat, but it also means that this is a great tool. Because you can conceivably use it without starting World War III. You can carry out attacks that don't bring society to its knees and conceivably get away with it. And historically, the attacks that we have seen, these actors kind of got away with it, right? It took years in most cases for us to even accuse them of doing it. The Olympics, I talk about the Olympics all the time. Sandworm or the GRU, who we were talking about earlier, attacked the Olympics. They tried to take the opening ceremonies offline. This was an attack on the entire international community. It took us 4 years before we even bothered to blame them for it, right? I mean, there's no hope for deterrence in a scenario where we don't even blame the actors for 4 years, right? And that is an incident that affected literally everybody in the international community. So I think that these actors recognize that they can get away with this type of activity, and that's what makes it such a good option for them. They were looking for those psychological effects. That's what they really want to do. They want to undermine our resolve, particularly in Ukraine. They want to undermine our elections elsewhere. They want to undermine our sense of security.
Great. Thank you. Max, you want to talk to us a little about NATO?
Yes, I mean, these are already great points that are mentioned, and I thought about the Olympics and realized that there's an obvious connection here, because with Olympic Destroyer, many weren't immediately convinced that it was Russia, right, John? And you'll know a lot more about that. But yeah, I wanted to take the conversation a bit towards the NATO alliance. And here's the main takeaway, is that whilst we have seen a convergence amongst alliance in terms of the need to develop a cyber posture, we actually have seen a divergence in what this posture should look like, in particular on offensive cyber and the role of the military. And let me talk 30 seconds about these three key components of what we can see as a cyber posture: capability, strategy, and then the legal understanding. So on the capability side, what we have seen since 2018 is now the majority of NATO members have established a military cyber command with some type of offensive mandate. But the difference in operational capacity today is enormous. So whereas you have, of course, particularly on one side, the US and several others who've really put the resources into operationalizing this command, the majority of NATO allies still have commands operating on a budget of a couple of million dollars. It's enough to be at least officially part of the cyber club, but certainly not enough to operate effectively in this domain. Now, the second one around strategy, yes, of course, all the countries have established a cyber strategy and particularly defense cyber strategy and have updated this repeatedly. Also there from 2018, we have seen some significant differences emerging, right? With the US developing the US Cyber Command's vision of persistent engagement, DoD strategy of defend forward, with a focus of operating globally, continuously, seamlessly, and also recognizing this activity below the threshold of armed attack that can still be strategically meaningful, and that the military cyber command has a role to play in potentially even conducting effect operations in peacetime. That is not something that most of NATO allies would be willing to do so, and changes the perspective across the Atlantic. And then the third one, which connects to this, is that what we've seen over the past few years is countries articulating, not just saying, okay, you know, international law applies, to which all allies agree, but how it applies. And we've seen a significant difference in, on the one hand, the camp of sovereignty as a rule with the Netherlands and France, but then on the other hand, the UK that says, you know, sovereignty doesn't apply in cyberspace. And the last point here is that it's dangerous to argue that these differences between the in the alliance come from simply differences in maturity. I think they're actually on a different policy path. And that requires, as a result of it, some real coordination and maybe and cooperation to at least bring these closer together.
Great points. So I'd like to start with diplomacy. Emily, you mentioned norms, you mentioned the lack of taxonomy. We got work to do, right? Where are nations currently succeeding and where are they falling short? And what diplomatic efforts should we be focusing our attentions on to make progress in this space?
Yeah, so I'll pick one from each category. I think where we're really succeeding is the cooperation at the tactical level, the kind of thing that Max mentioned with different levels of coordination, but it's happening. At the working level, people are sharing indicators, people are exercising together. Right now, Locked Shields is going on as a big NATO exercise. They say it's just a coincidence it's happening at the same time as Ukraine, but excellent timing. And that is how we win. The NATO alliance, the sharing of knowledge, the hunt forward, the defend forward teams, this is how we're gonna win in this domain. So I think that's where things are going well. Now, that level of tactical information sharing, of tactical cooperation, really needs to be paired with a strategic discussion. And that is hard for lots of reasons. When I was on the Hill and we were doing oversight of the government, people used to come in all the time and brief us, and you could boil down every single briefing to two words: it's hard and we're working on it. So I think that's true with this too. It's hard and we're working on it. But let me talk a little bit more about why it's hard and why we still need to work on it. The hard piece, the people who need to have those strategic level discussions are swamped. They are staring at China. They are staring at Russia, Ukraine. They are staring at, you know, a whole host of global issues, from supply chain to food shortages. Sitting down and having a strategic level, broad discussion about what the norm should be in cyberspace is like, yes, we should do that. That's about 15th on my list of priorities. We need to create the urgency before the urgency is created for us and really have those discussions. The other piece of that, I think, is that a lot of these concepts are very fuzzy and they're wrapped up in domestic values and national values. I mean, just here in the US, we have debates all the time about free speech and what can and cannot be regulated in cyberspace, given our First Amendment rights. Our European friends have very strong views on privacy and have implemented that in a whole host of different ways. And that bleeds into this debate as well. So it's difficult, but if you can take it up a few levels, my friend Sue Gordon always says that if you disagree down here, take it up a couple levels and get to a place where you agree. And that place where we agree is the norms and the values. This is a place where NATO allies, where like-minded democratic countries can sit down at a table and say, we all agree that spies are gonna spy, that's a thing that's gonna happen, but that when you're engaged in operations that affect human life, that affect public safety, that's a different level of threat. And that's where we need to be building the norms and the guidelines.
I'm so, so glad you brought up the point about being strategic and the lack of bandwidth there. We have to prioritize that if we are going to make progress, because quite frankly, there will always be the next Russia-Ukraine, the next ransomware attack, the next whatever. But if we're not making progress on these more strategic initiatives, we'll never come to that consensus. So Max, tell me, can we get some norms? Can we find consensus in NATO? What work should we be doing in NATO to do that?
Yeah, Max.
Let me pick up a point. Let me pick up on a point that John made, and then Emily as well, on the norms, and then also on the sharing side of things. So on the norm side, just to give a potentially annoying different angle, yes, we should think about red lines. And I think if we, I don't know how many people are currently sitting in the room, but I think everyone in the room can come up with a couple of different potential red lines that we should consider. No critical infrastructure attacks, financial system shouldn't be attacked, healthcare off limits, all of those things. But there is a second question now as well, particularly in the US, considering its change in threat perception, where it is argued, rightly so, I think, that activity below the threshold of armed attack can cumulatively still be strategically meaningful. Maybe 1 gigabyte of data being stolen by the Chinese is not a big deal, but doing this repeatedly is significant. So the second question is, what is not a red line? And that's actually a really hard question to answer. I've asked it a couple of times in different rooms, and rarely do I get like a very clear, coherent response of, okay, what is now like off limits and what, yeah, is actually allowed to be done. Because rarely is activity undertaken by an adversary that isn't strategic. But we have just argued that all strategic activity, you know, can it, like, shouldn't be done. So there's this strange kind of norms question here now that has emerged that haven't really resolved. The second point is on sharing. And I think it's a great point that Emily made on, like, you know, the importance of sharing. And in some ways we're doing this already, but equally, I think we're not doing it enough, right? So in the kind of at least the allied context, we've got a couple of different initiatives. The first one, most obviously, is the notion around sovereign cyber effects. We can't share tooling, we can't share exploits, what we're exactly doing, how we're operating, but at least we can collaborate on when we want to achieve certain effects. And secondly, what we can do, we can conduct these exercises together, such as locked shields and tunneling. I think that is not enough. Much more can be done and isn't done right now. And then particularly that comes in the cyber ranges and infrastructure side of things. I think that's where there is a space, which is one, incredibly costly for many countries to establish, to do it well. And second, where you see potential opportunities for collaboration, where the use of one country or one actor or one training program doesn't necessarily reduce the effectiveness of another country to use this as well. And so if I would make a push and recommendation, like what should allies do in the coming years, they should have a, I think even $1 billion cyber range for the training of their operators, developers, system administrators, and other people who are crucial for the workforce of military cyber commands and potentially intelligence agencies.
Great recommendation. John, I, you know, with all attacks intentionally below the line, with the need for more collaboration and creating a cyber range like Max is talking about, and the dynamic of cyber criminals being leveraged as a shield to continue to block the attribution we were talking about earlier, how can we make some progress in this space? Where should we be focusing our attentions in terms of deterrence?
I think there's a lot of good points. So I think we need to almost need to sort of rank and stack our problems, right? And that's not gonna, they're not going to change, or they're going to change constantly. Sorry, they always will be changing. But we've looked at a lot of different problems in the space, and I don't think we've really prioritized them. Good example: there's the ransomware problem, there's the elections problem, there's the espionage problem. I personally think that, you know, the espionage problem is probably the, you know, spies are going to spy. It is probably the least addressable issue. I think that the ransomware problem is probably the most addressable issue. You know, if you look at our vulnerability to that problem, it's you know, it's fairly large. These actors are they're now hitting a lot of critical infrastructure. We saw them hit healthcare during, you know, when in the like raging days of COVID. They're crossing a lot of lines, and at the very least, we want to push them back, you know, where they're not necessarily constantly pushing those lines. The election problem is another good example. It's not solved. In fact, the unfortunate reality is the last election we had, or the last, you know, major election we had, we saw new players get into the mix. So when the Proud Boys thing happened, my first instinct is like, well, the Russians did it, right? Like, I mean, I couldn't say that. I didn't have any evidence whatsoever. I'm like, well, here they are. We've been waiting and waiting. This is it. This is the play. It was the Iranians, mm-hmm. right? So now it's not even just the Russia problem. The problem is growing on us. I think we need to have a conversation about what problems we want to stop and start ranking them and going after them. I feel like we're sort of running from the one fire to the next, and that's not going to work. I do think the ransomware problem is largely addressable, and it is absolutely out of control, and potentially costing us the most money.
Can I jump in on the point of the Iranians and the Proud Boys? Because I went through that same roller coaster of emotions. There was a time around the 2018 elections and the 2020 elections where I just did not sleep because there was too much to worry about. The Proud Boys / Iranian problem was, I think, disheartening in that we saw this new player burst onto the market in grand fashion. But in a large way, it was a success story because the United States government and its allies, and that's a really key point, had their eyes open for this kind of potential activity. The excellent folks at DHS CISA had done a lot of prep work, so much prep work.
Absolutely.
To say to people, this is what's normal election problems, and this is what's more difficult election problems, something to be suspicious of. Then when this activity was noticed, it was located, attributed, downgraded, and released shockingly quickly.
Super fast.
I mean, it was 36
fast.
Hours.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So, I mean, this is actually, as upset as we all were to see it happen, this was actually a good news story in the way that it was handled. Now, to Max's point about red lines, I'm not sure that we were ready to do something to actually respond to the Iranians and try to create deterrence for the next time around. And that's where we need to do more work.
Agreed.
I think that's a great reminder about our point about being strategic and that prioritization that John talked about, the investment in attribution and getting things out there really quickly, are signs of that kind of coalescing around being more strategic and focusing there. How can we create actual consequences for the actors, particularly those hiding behind criminal groups and plausible deniability? And are our current tools working, right? That you said that this was a success story in the Iranian context, but a success to what end, right? Did we deter the behavior, or are we just able to make attribution? How are sanctions, attribution, indictments, all of those things actually moving us to a desired end? And I'll open that to any of you.
Yeah, so I can start off with that just because I brought up the point. I opened this Pandora's box. The Iranian thing was a success story in that we were able to broadcast very quickly to the American people who were in the midst of a very difficult election that this is not a thing. This is not real. This is not something you need to worry about. There are not these bad actors falsifying ballots all over the place. Now, we can leave aside the question of the domestic issues that happened in the 2020 election, but on this specific issue, it was a success in that it was mostly diffused. I would not call it a success in that there was a broader strategic policy response. You brought up several things there, the sanctions question, the indictments question. Sanctions are great until they're not. There's really only so much that you can do with a sanctions package. A lot of the individuals that you might be targeting with sanctions don't really care. There's ways that you can make life painful for a Russian oligarch. For a hacker who was working 10 levels down from a Russian oligarch, it's much more difficult to actually create some deterrent pain there. Indictments, same thing. If this person really wants to come visit their kids at college or take their kids to Disney World in the US, then, you know, great. But trying to find them and arrest them, it's really much more of a messaging tool than anything else. And I think, honestly, a tool of last resort. If you look at the way that DOJ and FBI operate, they are law enforcement officers. And what they want to do is build evidence and prosecute a crime. And that's just not the model that works effectively for these actors. It takes too long. It's too slow. And then while they're building a case for prosecution, they can't take the information and share it. Yeah. And that honestly is the most important piece. This is where I'm going to make a pitch for the private-public collaboration and the deep, deep importance of having the U.S. government and its entities and private sector operations that see this on the front lines on a daily basis, doing all of the collaboration possible to try to go after this problem set. It's my soapbox.
I think you've hit almost all the points I would have made. As we go through, you know, as far as the election situation went, I think we got into a place where we're talking about, you know, capability and intent, right? Or I actually got into a conversation with somebody from another country who's dealing with another actor, a non-Russian actor, and whether or not it was a question of capability and intent. And right now, the United States, we think, you know, Russia's got capability. The question is whether they have intent. In this other country, they said this actor has got intent, but the capability is just—it's not really there. And the problem with sort of not being able to deter, right, is that, and when these actors have intent, you're going to run into these black swan events, right? They will hit again and again and again, and they will be incidents that people don't even read in the news, right? The problem is that just because of the nature of technology, eventually there will be a major black swan event. They will get through. So the defense, which I would argue, I would argue you're absolutely correct. Our defenses, you know, for the elections were fantastic. Our response was fantastic. But if they keep trying, eventually they are going to get through. They are going to have something that makes it on the news, that causes a division in the U.S. electorate. I mean, there's all kinds of potential outcomes here. And that's what happens, I think, with an actor who is almost there on capability, but definitely there on intent. We have that black swan event. And I think a good example was the pipeline incident we saw, right? Yep. We have been warning, myself and my colleagues have been warning, this is coming, it's coming, it's coming. They're knocking over so many things. Someone's going to get hurt. Something important is going to go down. It's just a matter of time. And so I think if we can't figure out how to sort of approach the intent side, we're just talking about a matter of time before there's that black swan event.
Definitely agree. Max, anything on this one?
Yeah, just for all the talk that I mentioned about this divergence around NATO ally cyber posture, of course, the good thing here on imposing consequences is that what we have seen is a real development in the EU waking up that they have to think about this as well. And so the US, like the EU now with the cyber diplomacy toolbox, with like at least a degree set of measures in place as to what can be undertaken to respond, it means that the US is kind of not there alone anymore in thinking of how to impose costs, but can potentially do this even more effectively in a coordinated manner. And the second point is, and of course it also comes with the nature and the title of this our panel, is that when we talk about imposing costs, we do quickly get into the deterrence mindset and less into the mindset of how can we take the initiative away from our adversary? How can we make sure that we disrupt their activity? We're already kind of like in the second step of, okay, after this has been done, what can we do? But clearly the second question here is as relevant as well. And we've seen great strides in this domain, of course, over the past 2-3 years.
That's great. So I'm going to open it up for questions in just a minute, but I'm going to ask one more while you guys pull your questions together. We've talked a lot about Russia, Ukraine. There was a lot of talk about cyber attacks on the margins. It's a great illustration of if cyber capabilities continue to be leveraged, what will be the impact? Who will bear the brunt of the back and forth, of the tit for tat, as folks, grassroots cyber actors start to jump in and figure out how they play a role. What are we looking at? Who's going to bear the brunt and who will be playing in this space and how that impacts?
So when I talk about limitations, I got to be really clear. I think from a societal aspect, we're going to be fine when it comes to almost all this. There are a lot, you know, we made it through COVID-19, right? There are a lot of businesses in my neighborhood who are out of business now. So, altogether, we're going to be fine. My customers may take a real hit, right? And I think that's important to remember. The people who really are on the front lines are our private sector. And it's important to remember when we start employing these capabilities too. During one of these sort of little kerfluffles that we get into with Iran every now and then, I think there was some news of like a cyber attack against their capabilities. And it's important to remember that Iran's not going to retaliate against cyber command, right? They're gonna retaliate against some random company in the United States. That's who's gonna actually feel the burn from this stuff. So we have to keep that in mind no matter what we do.
Yeah, I would agree. This question of who is a combatant is going to be the thorny question of the next few years. I am reading Nicole Perwast's book right now, which is really good, very, very thorough. I would love to talk about my thoughts on the book, but one of the things that she outlines is the response inside Google when they first saw the cyber attack coming from China. And some of the quotes are priceless. You know, who would have thought that a nation state actor would be interested in Google? How could we possibly have been expected to respond to a nation state actor invading our territory? And that is a totally understandable perspective for somebody who was a startup and then grew this massive company and just never really had to think about it from a national security perspective. Now, for somebody like me, who spent 20 years basically in the intelligence community, I'm like, of course you're a target. Come on. But that's a product of my training and my upbringing that I tend to think this way and that they don't. So bringing these two sides together to collaborate, to cooperate, to try and share information is going to be absolutely critical. And I think American companies, European companies really thinking through whether they are going to be counted as a combatant, not by the US government, but by our adversaries, is a real challenge. The folks in the executive branch right now, Jen and Chris and Anne Triumvirate have done a really phenomenal job pulling together the JCDC and a lot of this collaboration between the private sector and the government. It's initial steps that really need to be built on. When you look at China and the way that they think about what is government versus what is private sector, that is not a distinction for them. They see government and they see those who help the government when we ask them to. In Russia, there's also really not a distinction between the oligarchy and the government. There's the government, and then there are all these tools of government that I can draw on whenever I want to, because they know where their bread is buttered. When we look at our adversaries and we say, no, 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 it's private sector, they go, oh yeah, right, of course. So I think that thinking through who counts as a combatant, how they're going to be affected by this next round of potential warfare is going to be really challenging. And this, I think we can talk about this during the Q&A a little bit more, but this question of red lines and escalation, this is where I think it gets really thorny. Mm-hmm. Because if Google gets hit, what does that mean for escalation?
Yeah,
Camille, it might be a bit boring, but I agree with already the previous panelists. It would be much nicer if I would disagree. But of course, the private sector will bear the most significant costs in case of some type of retaliation. But just to add maybe one point here is we often hear about, or this question being raised, will Putin potentially conduct a cyber operation against the West, against the US? Should we be concerned about? We should have our shields up, of course. But it's not just Putin, right? And I think we sometimes overestimate the amount of control that the Russian government has over such a wide set of criminal groups and other hacktivist groups that are operating in Russia. And, you know, as an academic, the most one of the most famous theories to understand these relationships is, of course, principal-agent theory. And where normally you would argue that the principal has the least control over the agent in case there are information asymmetries. And these are enormous here in terms of the asymmetry of information that these criminals have, in terms of targeting and what they are capable of, and who they want to target, which seems to suggest that agency slacking is very high. The risks that we may have these groups operating, yes, in favor of Russia, but not completely in control, is significant, and it increases the risk of, I think, a more of a WannaCry, not Petya type of scenario. Less kind of critical infrastructure attacks directly on the US, but certainly more consequential collateral damage type of attacks through ransomware or self-propagating malware.
I think the thing that is clear is the place we have been a bit strategic is in that collaboration between public and private sectors. And that's really important. I'm interested to see how that continues to evolve between the JCDC and the Cyber Safety Review Board and some of the other mechanisms that have been deployed of late. Do we have any questions to get us started?
We will take a virtual question from Adam Siegel.
Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for doing the panel. I'm sorry I can't be there with you in person. I think this question is for Max, although the others can, I guess, question my assumption. So Max, it seems as if in the US, the kind of debate about whether defend forward and persistent engagement is escalatory is over, of people basically believing that it is not. So I wonder if there's a different perception of that among, you know, the NATO allies that you spoke of, and if there is within NATO differences on that view.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think it's actually the discussion, I don't want to avoid your question, Adam. I think the discussion is less about, is it more or less escalatory? But the question is much more, I feel, a legal one. Like, should the military be allowed to operate in peacetime, potentially do this, you know, globally? What is then the relationship with intelligence? It's that question in particular that is holding, I think, many, particularly continental European countries back in developing a similar posture. So it's less of an escalation question and more of a legal bureaucratic question that that is constantly raised right now.
Anyone in the room? Yes,
back to him. Thank you. My name is Erin Dunbacher. I work for the Nuclear Threat Initiative. I wanted to first make a comment to your ranked order list of priorities. I would love to add operational technology and military systems there. Sometimes I think we have a lot of conversation about the IT side and maybe not enough about the OT. But my question is, to what extent do we really need to solve or pay attention not only to the attribution conundrum, but also to signaling in this space relative to escalation management? You know, we have other technologies for which globally there's some sort of recognition for what the movement of a bomber implies, or the or other types of maneuvers, or on the both the military and from the leadership side. Is it possible to build sort of clarity around what different cyber actions signal, in fact, and do we need to be working on that?
I think the best example of like cyber signaling I've seen has been our sort of read on the actions of an actor that's publicly called, we call them Isotope. They're called Berserk Bear, Dragonfly. They have this history of getting into U.S. They're FSB related. So Russia's actually their sort of their internal security service that they have a SIGINT mission. But anyway, for about a decade, they've been digging into U.S. critical infrastructure. And we looked at it in two ways. One, are they, you know, sort of digging in for like that moment when they need to be ready for the contingency? The other thing is, are they digging in to signal to us that they're digging in, right? That they are there in case they need to be. And I think that's probably one of the best examples, I think, of the sort of signaling I've seen in this space, because it's holding real capability or real infrastructure under threat. I'll be interested in any other examples or.
Yeah. Well, go ahead, Max.
No, I think you can speak more to this, Emily, but it just reminds me actually of a CFR blog post by Jay Healy, which is like, not the deterrence the US wants, with some great quotes from Ben Rhodes around the presidential election, where supposedly some of the US retaliatory options were taken off the table because of concerns of the FSB in particular being in US critical infrastructure. I don't know if that's true, but it's a fascinating case in terms of signaling and supposedly whether deterrence works or not. At least there might be one case where it has worked, but not in the way that we want it to. But you may know more about that, Emily.
I might. I'm going to put in a plug here for anybody who wants to read the Senate Intelligence 2016 Election Interference Report, because we do go into that a little bit. Yeah, so this was one of the problems with the Obama administration response in 2016. By the time they understood somewhat the extent of what the Russians were up to, they had very limited time before the election, and they had very limited prepared options. The other thing, it's easy now, and it was easy-ish in 2017, 2018, to look back on the complete package of information and say, well, clearly they should have known this. Well, when you're in the fog of war and when information's coming at you, you know, a piece at a time, day after day, it's a lot more difficult to make sense of a very foggy picture. But again, that's the reason why we have to be strategic now. We have to be thinking forward now. I wanted to make a point about the signaling question that you asked, which I love coming from a nuclear scholar. Nuclear scholars have spent decades talking about very precise signaling options and deterrence theory and how these things work together. And I think that folks in working in the cyber domain have a lot to learn from that scholarship. I think we need to be very careful about making comparisons though, because it's just a totally different set of tools. And the cyber domain is still so young that no one has figured that out yet. In nukes, you know, there's this finely tuned, you know, this signals this, and this is code for this. In cyber, it's like, nobody really knows what any of this means yet. And part of the big problem is that a lot of the tools are dual use. Mm-hmm. If you implant a tool in someone's systems, that tool could be used for espionage.
Absolutely.
It could be used for destruction, and you don't know. This gets to John's point about intent and capability. Maybe the adversary has the capability to implant this tool on your network. What's their intent? Are the Russians there to spy on a potential new administration? Are they there to tank confidence in an election? It's really not wise to sit back and wait to see which one it is.
There were two crews in the DNC. One was, you know, GRU, and the other one was SVR. And the SVR guys were just kind of spies being spies. They were abiding by the rules, sort of.
The GRU, on the other hand, some men just want to watch the whole world burn.
Question, yes.
Yeah, thanks. Steve Charnovitz, GW Law School. So we've heard a lot on the panel this morning and this afternoon about collaboration, public and private collaboration. But I was a little surprised when I heard earlier the question, what is the US government response to an attack on Google? And I would have thought that's the whole role of US government, to defend the public, including the US companies. So I'm wondering, I mean, do we expect Google to have its own international policy and international capability to defend itself? I would think not. I don't think we're trying to have Google take international military or cyber action. We might be comfortable with Google having a very activist environmental policy, but not a military or cyber policy as offensive. So it has to be, I assume, the US government who's going to defend Google. And so I'm wondering, are we doing enough as a government to defend and help our leading technology champions in the United States, if they're vulnerable, and I guess they are vulnerable, is the US government doing enough to safeguard?
Oh, Steve, I could go on like a 20-minute tear about this, but I'm not going to, because other people have questions. I think the short answer to the question, are we doing enough? No. The longer answer to the question, though, is what's appropriate? And I think this is what you're really getting at with your question. When Sony Pictures was hacked, lo those many years ago, that initially was a hands-off response by the US government, until it became clear that it was the North Koreans trying to silence free speech, and then the White House got involved. But still, I mean, was the FBI responsible for what happened at Sony? There was no way that Sony would have let the FBI into their systems ahead of the attack so that the FBI could have prevented it. It's not the FBI's job. They're, you know, feds, they're the ones supposed to be defending after the fact, finding the criminals and prosecuting them. That doesn't really work here. The US doesn't have a domestic spy agency. We don't have an MI5. The FBI is very poorly suited to the mission of trying to defend in advance of this kind of cyber attack. Your question about Google, you know, would we defend Google? Okay, so let's say we defend Google. Are we defending the cyber startup that has 5 employees and didn't pay any attention to security? Are we responsible for that? How are we defending them? I mean, I ask these questions knowing full well that I don't have the answer, and I don't think anybody does right now. Trying to find the right line between a business executing its own business practices properly, doing the simple things it needs to do, patching, two-factor authentication, you know, just the basic cyber hygiene stuff that everyone needs to do. And then at what point the government takes over as a response in a deterrent fashion. You can make a comparison to crime, which the FBI and local law enforcement is supposed to do, but that's after the fact and the damage is done. You can make a comparison to national defense. We all pay taxes so that we can buy aircraft carriers and, you know, F-22s. Should the government be thinking that way in the cyber domain? And if they are, what does that imply for the Googles of the world letting the feds into their systems? I can see the room cringing when I say that, because everybody says, no, you know, that's not the job of the US government. So what is the job?
Yeah, proactive defense is not likely to be the place where the US government plays. I mean, CISA has a strong mission for voluntary support and can help the small company all the way to the large company build up their defenses and be more proactive, implement the two-factor authentication, all of the things. And I think we'll continue to play in a voluntary space pre-attack. What we have to figure out is how we would stand up as a USG to support an organization depending on the severity of the attack. So Sony, we decided that, you know, trying to attack free speech, which was a fundamental constitutional right, something that we wanted to come after. We need to do that strategic work that we talked about earlier to figure out what those lines are, what necessitates support, what's a significant cyber incident that the US government would mobilize itself around that happens in the private sector. But there is unlikely to be a moment where all of the US companies open up their systems to let the US government do something on the proactive defense side of things.
Meanwhile, there's Mandiant.
Honestly, we've had our own incident, and I can't get too many details, but you know, we had a really strong, good experience working with the government as far as dealing with it. There are clearly things that we're very good at. Like, for instance, the incident response team that worked this problem are literally the best incident responders on the face of the planet. These are we handpicked a team of all stars. But we still needed the U.S. government's help, and they were able to fill in a lot of gaps that made the whole process easier and better.
Which is why that proactive collaboration is so important. The trust that needs to be built between the private sector and the public sector is what'll get us further, so that in the event of an incident, companies are pulling the government in early so they can enrich their data with the information that they have, and vice versa, we can declassify things, all of that. That's why that collaboration proactively and consistently is going to be so important. Next question, Monica.
Hi, everyone. Monica Ruiz, Microsoft. So earlier in the conversation, you all talked about the importance of strategic engagement and also information sharing in the context of international cyber norms, or norms red lines. So I'm curious how you all think about countries that don't necessarily have the capacity to engage strategically and to share information. How do you think about building that capacity, especially in the context of what is going on in the United Nations as part of the open-ended working group, the OEWG? And the fact that the previous report essentially was endorsed by a lot of countries and reaffirmed the 11 norms that came out of the 2015 UNGGE group. And so I'm curious how you guys think about sort of building that capacity beyond the countries that actually have it right now. Thank you.
So we have some experience working in areas that don't necessarily have a lot of customers, but we still find value working there because we learn a lot. And I think that's one way to sort of get the private sector involved in these sort of problems. Some of the areas that are on the front lines can't necessarily afford the million dollar security solutions, right? But they can offer a lot of great information. The bleeding edge of a lot of threats have been in places that I've tracked in history, historically, have been in places, in India and Taiwan and Ukraine and in the Middle East. And not on every occasion where was a customer relationship. You have to go in there and develop partners. And those partners oftentimes pay you back in the form of information that you use to secure your other customers. So there is value there. It's just not necessary. It's not necessarily, the normal sales process.
Yeah, you'll see companies investing that raise the collective level of cybersecurity so that, because we all will benefit from it. On the USG side, I think that's an important question that we need to be focused on. The strategic investments and collaboration, the support that we provide now will have a direct impact on the norms discussions and the multilateral bodies we are engaging in that will dictate how we engage on cyber in the future. And so it is a strategic imperative and part of that strategic conversation that needs to keep happening to be focused on how we engage with smaller nations and nations that are developing capabilities. So it's important.
Just to come in with one quick comment. I think it's a great question, Monica. And what we really see is a capacity gap in terms of the countries that are actually able to attribute and not able to attribute. And where at least where we have to get to the level of those countries who are unable to attribute, and as a result of that, are very hesitant to follow the public attribution statement of maybe their allies or other countries, get them to at least the capacity to verify attribution claims. And that's a starting one. Now, of course, that comes with a number of issues, one of which being that attribution is not only the Sherlock Holmes type of process that companies like Mandiant are involved in, where you collect the different puzzle pieces on, where the C2 is set up or all of those kind of things to come to a conclusion, is also a more proactive process sometimes, particularly by the mature actors being already in adversarial systems and see the attack going out. Now, in that second case, you have a high level of attribution confidence, but it's even harder to share with a wide number of other countries. But on the first one, yeah, I think getting Microsoft, other companies involved in training programs to at least ramp up the capacity to verify would be a good first step.
Another virtual question?
We will take our next question from Zaid Zaid.
Hi, Zaid Zaid from Cloudflare. I have a question about companies that continue to operate in Russia. There have been a number of articles. There's a lot of attention paid to who's leaving, who's staying, et cetera, how they're winding down their services. Cloudflare, as well as a number of other companies, is still in Russia. We provide internet security. We provide VPN services. And one of the things that us staying there has allowed Russians to do, is to get information from outside of Russia. But there's also been this push to, close Russia down from the internet in some ways. I would just love to hear how you all think about that.
Well, I tend to be in favor of keeping Russia widely connected to the internet. In fact, throwing every pipeline of information you can in there. This is a difficult question for so many companies to leave or not to leave. And if you leave, what does that really mean for the long term? I've been from the beginning of this whole thing talking about how it's not going to be a short fight. I don't see how it's going to be a short fight. And if as a company, you can't be out of Russia for more than 6 months or a year, then think very hard about pulling out now, because what happens in a year when you have to go back in, or else your business model can't survive? What message are you sending then? I think there are lots of ways to support the Ukrainian people. And I think that every company has to make their own decision here. I, for one, have been heartily encouraged by seeing the outpouring of support for Ukraine that has come from the private sector. I mean, citizen sanctions have in a way done as much good or more good than what the governments have done. I think it sent a very strong message. And I think the repercussions on the Russian economy are gonna reverberate for years and be very difficult to undo. So I think every company really has to make their own decision, and then do what you got to do to explain that to your customers, your shareholders. If the basic fundamental goal is to support the Ukrainian people and then continue to speak truth inside Russia, I think that's a noble goal.
Without getting into the information flow, I think what one of the really interesting things that happened really early is that with regards to the sort of citizen sanctions, is we watched a lot of organizations, a lot of customers take very clear public stances on the war, including divesting themselves from Russia. And at one point we were like, okay, we need to figure out who these people are and try, because they're sort of essentially putting themselves on a higher risk profile. It got to the point where it was almost impossible to track. The bad news is I think you've raised your threat profile. The good news is so many people have done it now that I don't think it matters almost. It's become
safety in numbers.
Yeah, so there's safety in numbers. Yeah. I don't know if you could really, if it had been one organization, really early on, I think we saw some of the international gaming or sporting organizations, for instance. I was like, well, that's, they have a history of hitting these sports organizations. Putin loves sports. It's like a thing for him. We were really kind of worried about it. But now everybody's done it. So I'm actually it's sort of encouraged by the fact that there is the safety in numbers problem.
Yeah.
The only thing I'll add is I know many of the companies have real physical security concerns as they evaluate this, and they want to protect their people. So they're weighing that as part of that strategic decision. And so it's definitely not a complicated, I mean, it's not a decision without complication. And so they're probably weighing a number of factors as they determine what to do.
Yeah.
And then the insider risk threat has just increased so enormously for the country's staying.
Absolutely.
Major concern.
Next question. Okay. Oh, I think that's it. Well, thank you all for joining us for this discussion. The questions from the audience were rich. The comments from the panel were rich. And so I think we all have left with a mandate to be more strategic and collaborate with the government and to be thinking long-term so that we can get ahead of some of these issues. So thank you all for the time. A big thank you to the panelists and to CFR for having us.